and a hush fell over the crowd. Happy Father's Day. We get an opportunity to remember those fathers that are with us, those that are not, but just to spend a minute being thankful to our Heavenly Father for the men that have been put into our lives here to guide us and teach us the goods and the bads and the ups and the downs, right? So we are thankful that we're all here together. We're going to sing a few songs, and we're going to start by reading a scripture. So if you want to stand with us from Psalm 75. Remember, read with out loud. Yes? We praise you, God. We praise you, for your name is near. People tell of your wonderful deeds. You say, I choose the appointed time. It is I who judge with equity. When the earth and all its people quake, it is I who hold its pillars firm. To the arrogant I say, boast no more. And to the wicked, do not lift up your horns. Do not lift your horns against heaven. Do not speak so defiantly. No one from the east or the west or from the desert can exalt themselves. It is God who judges. He brings one down, he exalts another. In the hand of the Lord is a cup full of foaming wine mixed with spices. He pours it out, and all the wicked of the earth drink it down to its very dregs. As for me, I will declare this forever. I will sing praise to the God of Jacob, who says, I will cut off the horns of all the wicked, but the horns of the righteous will be lifted up. Father God, thank you for this opportunity that we have to sing those praises, and God, to speak the words that have been recorded for us in Scripture. And God, I just ask that you just fill this place and our minds as we sing these words and as we worship you, our Heavenly Father, a living God who sent his Son to die for us. But God, that death didn't end his story, God, that we have a hope through his resurrection, a hope of eternity with you in heaven. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty, through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior.
I believe
in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that he will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Thomas said to him, my Lord and my God.
And our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light.
Forever seated high.
I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Eternal.
I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
I've heard.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Oh, ready? Sorry.
I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am. Who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us.
Sing that again.
You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. Love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love. Love, love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Father, Father God, thank you for being that constant good father. It relies on nothing else but your perfectness and your love for us humans you created in your image. God, thank you. I need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee every hour, stay thou nearby. Temptations lose the power when thou art nigh. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. I need thee, I need thee. I need thee every hour. I need thee, I need thee. I need thee every hour. I need thee every hour. And abide, for life is vain. I need thee every hour, teach me thy will, and thy rich promises in me fulfill. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. God, thank you for being there for us when we need you. We pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Morning. Happy Father's Day to all you fathers. I get that Father's Day may be a bittersweet day for some of you. That's okay. We'll be praying for you. My name is Troy Leathers. If I haven't met you, I look forward to doing so. I'll be taking us through our time of communion. I'm going to take this time now to turn it over to our Heavenly Father and take a look at what God has to share and what it says about his grace and promises. All throughout Scripture, God promises to redeem his people. He promises to rescue them and free them from their bondage to sin and brokenness. God accomplishes this through Jesus. Jesus gave his life for once and for all, which means he doesn't have to die again. All of your sins, your past, your present, your future, all forgiven. In fact, nothing can separate you from the love that God has for you. Let's take a look at Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace. So today, as you gather your communion elements, I want you to remember and reflect about Jesus, his sacrifice, him giving up the blood, shedding his blood on the cross and his body. Do you feel forgiven? Or are you still carrying the weight of whatever mistakes you may be dealing with? Spend some time thinking about what God says. His great love and grace, what he's done for you. Remind yourself of God's promises. Ask him to fill you with the knowledge of his love and his grace. If you haven't gathered your communion elements at this time, you may do so. We have three stations, one to the left and the right of this platform, one in the back. For those in the balcony, there's one in the central area. If you need assistance, raise your hand. We'd be happy to help you. And after a personal time of reflection, you may partake of it. I'm going to offer up a word of prayer, and then I'm going to turn it over to you for your time to commune with God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your love, your grace, for sending your son, your one and only son, Jesus, sacrifice himself for us and our sin. And we're so thankful for what that means for us, that we have hope of eternity because of it. As we come today, Lord, just let us reflect upon that. Help us this week to be committed and determined and disciplined to stay in your word and learn more about your love and grace and all we say and do. It's your precious name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Middle and high school, you guys are dismissed. Happy Father's Day. It's the worst holiday ever. I read or saw something this week that said Christmas is the number one most celebrated holiday. Anybody got any guesses on number two? What's that? Mother's Day. Anybody got any guesses on number three? I have no idea either. But I did read that Father's Day ranks somewhere around 16. I don't even know of 13 other holidays. I looked at it, like Arbor Day is number 13. Like, what is Arbor Day? I don't know. But happy Father's Day. Let me just tell you, I'm going to finish up our series In God We Trust this morning with this idea of when Christians get it wrong. You ever got it wrong? Happened to me one time. And we'll finish that up. I want to tell you, this May, I celebrated 20 years here in ministry. And this year is number 11 of being the lead pastor. And so I'm going to be in and out of the office, but we're going to have some of our elders preaching the next 4 weeks. So I'm going to take a little bit of time off to do some personal study and reflection and those types of things about where we need to be as a church, where God wants me to be. And so we'll take some time to do that. Like I said, I'll be kind of in and out of the office and those types of things on different days, but I wanted to make you aware of that. But I want you to still to come and be here because God's church is not built on Chris, but God's church is built on the hope and grace and mercy and love of Jesus Christ. Amen. And so it's not about me, it's about him. And so I just wanted to tell you a little bit about that. Sometimes we do everything right as dads. Dads, I was waiting for you to go, amen. I underhanded it to you. He said, all the men conditioned, like, don't say nothing. Sometimes we do everything right as dads, but then sometimes we get it wrong. I am blessed beyond belief to have had a dad who was an amazing man. Let me tell you a little bit about him. My dad drank a little bit, and sometimes a little too much. My dad worked really long hours. My dad missed most of my sporting events. My dad didn't eat dinner with us but a couple times a week. Believe it or not, sometimes my dad used bad language. You may be wondering, that doesn't sound like the picture of an amazing dad. It would appear that that sounds like the picture of someone who got it wrong. And let me tell you, my dad got some things wrong. But he also got some things right. My dad also humbled himself and acknowledged that he couldn't make it through this world alone. My dad went seeking for God and found him. My dad developed a desire and a passion for the Word of God like I've not seen
very often. My dad started attending church. He gave his life to Christ and was baptized into Christ. He continued to devour God's word. My dad got a copy of the Bible on tape and completely wore out one set of cassette tapes. Some of you wondering what cassette tapes are, Google it. My dad became an adult Sunday school teacher and died a faithful follower of Christ. While my dad got some things wrong, he got the most important thing right. He knew that he couldn't do it on his own, but he needed the grace and truth of God. We all need grace and truth. And so let me just tell you before I jump into the passage this morning that there are some of you here or watching online or will watch online eventually that at this point in your life, you need to experience the grace of God. You need to experience His unparalleled love and grace. There are also some of you this morning that need to experience the truth of God's word. That God doesn't just desire us to be and stay where we're at, but God desires us to be renewed and transformed into something greater. If you've got a Bible or maybe you've got the Bible app, I want you to open up to John chapter 1. I'm going to read just a few verses and then we'll jump in. John chapter 1, I'm going to start in verse 1. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through Him all things were made. Without Him nothing was made that has been made. In Him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. I'm going to slide down to verse 14 of John chapter 1. It says, the Word became flesh. Who's he talking about? He's talking about Jesus. The Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us. We have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Jesus is full of grace and full of truth. Not partially grace, not partially truth, but completely grace and completely truth. Jesus didn't just pull out grace and truth when it was convenient. No, Jesus was completely grace and completely truth. Pray with me real quick. God, Lord Jesus, thank you for today. Thank you for your word. And God, we thank you for not only your grace, but your truth. And Father, I just ask that you would open both of those to us this morning. Father, we pray all these things in the powerful name of your Son, Jesus, and our Savior. Amen. We need to get it right. Sometimes we get it right, but sometimes we get it wrong, but I think we need to get it right. While there are room for mistakes, we need to make every effort when it comes to living for God to get it right. Most scholars believe, and I tend to agree, that we find ourselves living in a post-Christian culture. Anybody would say, well, what is a post-Christian culture? For a long time, and I've mentioned this before, the church or followers of Christ were the home team. They were celebrated all that was good. It didn't take long before the church, followers of Christ, became the visiting team. And now I'm not sure that we're even desired to be at the event. What a post-Christian culture really means is it's this idea that most people around us know who Jesus is and they know what he did, but they don't care. You see, we've moved beyond just a fact of a point in America where people don't know who Jesus is, but we're living in a place where most people know who Jesus is. They know what he's done, but they really don't care. So how do we faithfully represent Jesus in a post-Christian culture if we're going to have a chance at reaching people in our culture with the grace and truth of Christ, we better get it right ourselves. In a world that's more divided than ever, we need to represent God in a God-honoring way. I'm convinced that a divided world needs a united church more than ever. Let me just say that one more time because it's tweetable or Xable. I don't know what it's called now. A divided world needs a united church more than anything. No matter what's going on in our world and our culture, we still need to live out love and grace and truth. Let me remind you what John chapter 1, verse 14 said. The Word became flesh, made His dwelling among us. We have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of... Just keep repeating it. I'm going to say it multiple times. Grace and... Full of grace and truth. Do you know someone who's full of something? Notice I didn't ask you what they were full of. Maybe you do. Full, the Greek word used here, means to be filled to the brim. It's this idea, we get this image from this Greek word that means like if you had a glass and it was so full, you've filled that glass before where the water is just kind of bubbling, like you know at any, if you were to move that at all, it would just overflow and come out of the glass. That's this idea of full here. Jesus is full to the brim of both grace and truth. Jesus is full of grace, which saves, and truth, which frees. But sometimes we get those things wrong. Believe it or not, I don't like all Christians. I'm writing a sermon right now on lying, and so I just wanted to be honest. I don't like all Christians because Christians like to pick sides. And I think a lot of times Christians pick sides when it comes to grace and truth as well. Like you'll find people who are all truth people. And the truth is great. The truth sets you free. The truth is powerful. But you know some people who are all truth. And what happens when people are all truth? They become judgmental, they become mean, they become out of touch. When someone is all truth, it often looks like this. The Bible says it, I believe it, and that settles it. If you dress differently for church, or if you behave differently, they just look at you and say, go to hell. Where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. That's all truth. And then on the other side of that, we've got people who just are all grace people. And all grace people are like, it doesn't matter what you do. Hey, God loves everybody. We're all sinners, bro. Who are you to judge me? It's all grace and no truth. But when we pick to be two extremes, either all truth or all grace, those two places lead to two very big problems. Because truth without grace leads to rebellion. Truth without grace leads to rebellion. All truth with no empathy, with no understanding, with no love leads to rebellion. You don't believe me? Look at a home based on rules, regulations, and religion, and I'll show you some kids that will eventually rebel. But on the other flip side is grace without truth leads to relativism. And relativism is this idea that there is absolutely no truth. What's good for me is good for me, And what's good for you is good for you. And if what's good for me and what's good for you, then who can really tell me, including God, what to do if there is no truth? But Jesus is full of grace and full of truth. I believe the problem in our culture and in our churches is that instead of being full of Jesus, we just want a little bit of Jesus. Like our Bibles, we just want a little bit of Bible. Like we don't want enough Bible to be renewed or transformed, but maybe a verse a day will keep the devil away. Like, we don't want to be full of Jesus. We don't want to be full of his word. We don't want to be full of his church. Like, we take just a little bit of church. Like, if we don't have another thing going on, we'll go to church. Like, maybe if the kids don't have a sporting event, we'll go to church. Maybe if our favorite band's not playing at the winery. Preaching a little bit now, huh? Then we'll go to church. But we don't serve, we don't give, we don't get involved. We want just enough Jesus to feel better about ourselves, but not enough Jesus to be different. But Jesus is full of grace and full of truth, a grace that saves and a truth that sets us free. The word grace is a word, a Greek word called charis, which means undeserved kindness, the goodwill or favor of God. If you take the word grace, it is spells out God's riches at Christ's expense. We receive all the riches of God at Christ's expense. There's nothing that you and I can do to earn that favor of God. Ephesians chapter 2, starting in verse 4, says this, "But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in our transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved, and God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." I want you to take just a moment, and I want you to look down your aisle. Go ahead. Look down through there. Look all the way across. Look back and forth. Look all the way across. Let me ask you this. Who needs grace? Oh, don't point. Don't raise no hands. Just do the thing. You ain't trying to get me fired here on 20 years in one day. Who needs grace? You look around, who needs grace? Maybe if you look down the aisle, you see mom. A mom who wants to be like all the other moms, who wants to have the designer clothes and the Instagram fame. As you look down the aisle or around the room, maybe you see dad who's hyper work focused. He's focused on money and he's greedy. He'd give up everything for the next dollar. Maybe as you look down the aisle or around the room, you see that young person who's running after alcohol and drugs and sex and is destroying everything in their path. Maybe you see the couple who has lived a little bit of life, who's been hurt and is having a hard time forgiving those hurts. Maybe as you look down the aisle or around the room, you see the church person who wonders why all the rest of us can't get our lives together. Wondering why we're not following God more closely. Who needs grace? They all do. They all need grace, but sometimes we get it wrong. I'm afraid that sometimes in church, we act and maybe even say, if you behave and believe, then you can belong. And if you quit behaving, we'll gossip about you and call it prayer. Mm-hmm. You didn't know this last one before I took a little break, gonna hit, wasn't it? You see, far too often we tell people, look, if you behave and you believe, then you can belong. But that can't be true for Lake Christian Church. That can't be true for God's people. Let me just tell you that long before you believe, you belong here. Long before you behave and got life all figured out, you belong here. That's grace. That's the grace of God. But Jesus is not only full of grace, he's also full of truth. Romans chapter 6, starting verse 1. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? You see, we must lead with grace, but we must proclaim truth. While grace is completely unbelievable, we must also proclaim truth that God desires us to be better. While God accepts and loves us exactly where we're at, exactly in this moment, God desires for me to be renewed and transformed into something different. He doesn't want to leave me like I am. The truth is not just the rules. The truth is not just regulations. The truth is a person. The truth is a relationship. John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus answers, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. John chapter 8, verse 32 says, then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. I want you to take one more moment and look back down the aisle. Look around the room. You see that critical. Keep looking. Keep looking, because you're going to spot these people. You see that critical, jealous woman? Let me just tell her this morning, you're loved. You're welcome here. You belong here. That's the grace of God. But the truth is, envy will rot your soul. There is a way to healing. There's a way to freedom. And it's called loving and blessing and serving others. It's called considering others better than yourself. That's the truth of God's word. Keep looking around. You see him? You see the greedy husband? Let me just tell you, you're loved. You are loved. You belong here. But the truth is, the love of money is the root of all evil. There's a better way. God says, more blessed to give than to receive. Keep looking around. You see that couple who's been hurt by life and having a hard time forgiving others? Let me just tell you, you are loved. You're doing a great job leading your small group. You're loved. You belong here. That's grace. But the truth is that unforgiveness is a significant problem. The truth is, Jesus demands us to forgive in the same way he forgave us. The truth is, unforgiveness will be a hindrance to your intimacy with God. Look around. Look around. You see the church person? You see him? He's the hardest one for me to like. He's judgmental. But he's loved. He's loved and he belongs here. You see, he's a mess, but I'm a mess too. We just happen to be two different messes. That's grace. But the truth is that pride comes before the fall. The truth is, if you exalt yourself, God will humble you. The truth is, but if you humble yourself, God will exalt you. Grace saves, but the truth sets you free. Look around. Look down the aisle. Look around the room. You may be thinking to yourself, didn't you miss one? The one who was chasing drugs and alcohol and sex and was destroying everything in life. I didn't skip it. It's right here. And I brought it up here because this is my chair. A young man who chased all those things. A young married man who was led by bitterness and anger and destroyed all kinds of things around me. This is my chair. I can tell you about Jesus full of grace and full of truth because it's because of his grace that I'm able to do what I do. But God's grace saved me. But God didn't desire me to stay there. God's truth, the truth of his word is God desired me to be something better, to be renewed, to be transformed into something great. Jesus is full of grace and full of truth. Let me tell you this morning, no matter where you are right now in this very moment, no matter what you've done, no matter what's in your past, the grace of God is that he loves you no matter what. But the truth of God is that he desires you to not only find Jesus, but to follow him. I want you to know that Jesus is still full of grace and he's full of truth. Maybe you need a little grace this morning. Maybe you need a little truth. This morning, don't leave here the same as when you came in. Let's be transformed by a God who's full of grace and full of truth.
Stand with us. We're going to sing a song about the splendor of our King. And the place that he can come from to provide that grace and truth back to us. So sing with us.
His voice, trembles at his voice.
How great is our God?
How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great.
By becoming obedient to the cross, death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Name above all names. Father God, this is our offering, our voices and our hearts. Oh God, more than that, our actions as we go out this week. Let our actions be our act of worship throughout the week. Let our actions be a reflection of you, of your grace, and of your truth. God, protect us from getting it wrong and soften the hearts and the minds and the ears of those who we get to interact with. God, it's a privilege to reflect you. We are so thankful for that opportunity. God, we are so thankful that your Son, the Word, truth, came to this earth and died for us because you love us. And Father, we thank you for that. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great week, everyone.